How did the world get so messed up, eh? Man, I tell you what, one of the things that I see missing in so many people's life, and that's peace. That's peace. And I tell you what, there's something about peace that we can't stir up on our own. It's not something that we can just happen, but we can choose peace. We don't have to live in the chaos. We don't have to give in to all the things that's going on around us. And so I want us to just give this time to God right now, and I want us to just go to the Lord in a word of prayer here. Fathers, we do look into your message about peace and what that looks like. God, I pray that you would open up our lives. Lord, you'd open up our hearts. Lord, I pray for whatever distractions that we brought in here today, God, we just kind of clock out from those distractions for just a minute. Lord, I pray that we would all, each and every one of us, we'd look at this message and say, how does this apply to my life personally? Not somebody else's, or I wish somebody else was here to hear this. But Lord, how does it apply to my life? God, we give it to you right now. Have your way in and through us in Jesus' name. Amen. So I heard about this man who prided himself on being extremely punctual. He was on time and was punctual in everything he did. He followed a very precise schedule every morning, and because of this precise schedule that he followed, he found great peace and comfort in his routine. He found peace in knowing that he had the same thing lined out, planned out every single day, and he found great peace in that. His alarm went off at 6:30 a.m., and he rose briskly. He shaved, showered, and ate his breakfast. He brushed his teeth, he picked up his briefcase, and he got into the car. He drove to a nearby ferry landing, and he parked his car, and he rode the ferry across to the downtown business area. He got off the ferry, and he walked smartly to his building. He marched to the elevator, he rode to the 17th floor. He hung up his coat, opened up the briefcase, spread his papers out on his desk, and he sat down in his chair at precisely 8 a.m. Not 8:01, not even 7:59, but always 8 a.m. Talk about OCD. We got anybody like that in here today? You know, he followed this same routine without variation for 8 years until one morning his alarm didn't go off and he overslept 15 minutes. When he did awake, he was panic-stricken and his peace was gone and everything turned to chaos. He rushed through his shower. He nicked himself shaving. He burned himself gulping down his breakfast. Only halfway through brushing his teeth, he grabbed up his briefcase. He jumped into the car. He sped to the ferry landing. He jumped out of his car, and he looked over for the ferry, and there it was. It was on the water, and it was a few feet away from the dock. And he said to himself, man, I think I can make it. And he ran down the dock towards the ferry just at full speed. He reached out to the edge of the pier, and he gave an enormous leap out and over the water, and he miraculously landed with a loud thud on the dock of the ferry. The captain rushed down to make sure he was all right, and the captain said, man, was that a tremendous leap. He said, but if you would have just waited another minute, he said, we would have reached the dock and you could have just walked on. You know, this man was experiencing peace, wasn't he? Until one thing happened. One thing went wrong, and then another thing went wrong, and another thing went to wrong, and it seemed like everything ended up turning into chaos in his life. I would say he was looking for peace in the wrong source, wouldn't you? He was looking for peace in a routine, and I tell you, you can't find peace in a routine. You can't find peace in your calendar. You can't find peace in your schedule. You can't find peace in anything like that. Because when you find peace in the right source, when you find it in the right source, then an interruption in your routine won't spiral your life into a total chaos. But see, so many of us, this is a picture of our life. You know, we might experience peace every once in a while for a brief moment. You know what? Things are going real good. I'm experiencing just a little bit of peace. But for the most part, it doesn't seem to hang around that long. It seems like peace comes in and leaves just as quick as it gets here, and it's gone. You know, we always have someone or something trying to come against the peace in our life. It seems like that we always have something or on our schedule to do. And most of the times our schedule seems to be so overly packed that we don't even know whether we're coming or going. We look down at the calendar and I almost get anxiety just having Rhonda tell me what we have going on this week. Because I sit here and think, how am I going to schedule anything else into this? And that's the way most of our lives are. We have so many things on the schedule, just struggling for our peace and to do that. We always have somebody that we're not going to get along with. We always have somebody we don't see eye to eye on. We always have somebody that seems like they're mad at us. Or we always have something that we're worrying about, constantly worrying about this or about that. And we find ourselves saying, man, I wish I could just have a little bit of peace in my life. Have you ever said that before? Man, I wish I could just have a little bit of peace in my life. If only I didn't have to deal with so-and-so. You know so-and-so. Everybody's got a so-and-so. Some of you are married to your so-and-so. Don't say amen. But only if I was married, you know, if I didn't have so-and-so in my life, I'd have a little bit of peace. If only I didn't have to do this or that, I'd have a little bit of peace. Or if only I didn't have to worry about these things that I have to worry about, then I could have just a little bit of peace in my life. You ever said that before? Anybody? You know, listen, guys, we're always going to have a calendar full of obligations to meet. We're always going to have days that don't go our way as planned. We're always going to have people in our lives that some are good and some are bad. We're always going to have circumstances in our life that we go through that honestly just kind of seem unpleasant. However, with all this being said, we do have a choice in each scenario. We have a choice in each one of our scenarios that we go through. And can I tell you, the choice that we make determines whether we're going to have chaos or peace in our life. You do have a choice. You have a choice how you go through things. And in our scripture today, we're going to continue in the book of Philippians. You know, we've made it all the way to chapter 4, and there's only four chapters in Philippians. We've been hanging out here for a little while because there's so much detail and there's so much that Paul is trying to get across to us and teach us. So we're coming up to kind of towards the end. I don't know whether next week or the week after will be the last of this, but I tell you what, the Philippians, the letter to the Philippians is such a wonderful thing. And I hope honestly that each one of these messages kind of has shed a different light on the subject in these passages that we've went through. In fact, I hope when you go back, what I want to encourage you to do, when you go back, reread all of Philippians in one setting. And I hope that the words meet just a little bit different since we looked into it in detail in that. But we're going to go ahead and go through in chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. And in these scriptures, Paul's going to show us how we can choose peace, how we can choose peace even in the midst of a chaotic world. Because, guys, we can't change the world around us, but we can change how we go through it. And I want to go through it in peace. How about you? So Philippians 4, 1 through 9. Starting with verse 1, the Apostle Paul says this. He says, therefore, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, dear friends. I plead with Euodia and I plead with Syntyche to be the same mind of the Lord. Yes, I have, and I ask you, my true companion, help these women since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of the co-workers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Verse 8, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if there is anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. So the goal of today's passage is found in verse 7 and 9. Paul said in verse 7, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Then he goes on to verse 9 and he says this, whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. So in other words, Paul's saying this. He's saying, whatever I've taught you, whatever you've seen from me, whatever you've learned from me, hey, if there's any of these things, put these things into practice. Listen to me, and the God of peace will be there for you. Guys, I'm telling you, if you want to experience authentic peace in this chaotic world, then there's a few things we need to do. And to find them answers, we have to kind of go in reverse a little bit. 7 and 9 tells us that we can have these peace. So we're going to look at the passage or the scriptures following up to that so we can get that end result of peace. And the very first thing that the Apostle Paul says that we need to do is Roman numeral number 1 on your outline is you need to change your view. We need to change our view. You see, the Apostle Paul had a much different view when it come to life than what we do. The Apostle Paul looked through different set of lenses than what we do. Let me tell you how most of us view life. We view life through an earthly lens. We view life through an earthly view of things. And can I tell you, when we view life with an earthly view, we tend to be a little more on the selfish side, don't we? Can I get an amen? We do. An earthly view of things, we are a little bit more selfish. You know what I'm talking about? We develop this, I want my way approach of things. We want our way to be done. And if it's not good for me, then, you know, I don't know if I'm interested in that. You know, I'm not interested if I, you know, want to go make things right. I'm not interested in maybe serving. I'm not interested in doing this. I'm not interested in doing that. If it's not good for me and I don't see immediate results, then I don't know that I'm interested in it. Guys, that's an earthly view of things. And Paul says we can't do like that. We can't have an earthly view. Paul seen things differently, and that's why he experienced peace. Let me tell you what happens. The problem is what happens when we have an earthly view of things. You know what happens? We lack authentic relationships with others. If we have an earthly view of things, then we are going to lack authentic relationships with others. Well, what do you mean by that? Well, if it's always going to be my way, if I'm never going to put others first, then it's going to be hard for me to get past a surface relationship with somebody else. Any more than a high five or a hey, how you doing? Because I'm afraid if I expose myself that much longer to have a good relationship with somebody, then that might require a little bit from me, right? It might require me giving up a little bit of my selfishness, because I tell you what, a good relationship comes when both people lay their self aside and put the others first. So when we have an earthly view of things, we lack authentic relationships. We lack compassion for others. We lack compassion for others. Because see, if it's all about me, then you know what? I'm going to look at the homeless person. I'm going to look at the person with no food. I'm going to look at the person that has a need. I'm going to look at this. I'm going to look at that. And I'm going to be like, you know what, man? I'd really love to help that person. However, I just don't have a lot of time. I don't have a lot of time because, remember, I told you about my schedule that I already have anxiety. You know? So how am I going to fit in helping somebody else? Isn't that right? So when we have an earthly view, we lack compassion. Because of an earthly view, it can also lead to conflict with others. Because if I'm demanding my way and you're demanding your way and we both have an earthly view, guess what's going to happen? Our best friend thing's going to go right out the window. Our relationship, our marriage, our business partners, everything that we do is going to go right out the window because we have an earthly view. And so therefore, without that, we're going to have the absence of peace in our life, right? So an earthly view leads to conflict with others. An earthly view also leads to lack of endurance for the things of the Lord. You know, all these things, guys, and many more, is going to lead to an absence of peace in your life. You see, the Apostle Paul, he experienced peace in all circumstances. He did. He had a peace in all circumstances because he did not have an earthly view. You know what the Apostle Paul had? He had a kingdom focus. He had a kingdom focus. He wasn't focused on himself. He wasn't focused on an earthly view. He had a kingdom focus. You know, we see in this passage and the prior passage that we actually read last week, and Paul starts off in verse 1, and he says, therefore. Verse 1 says, therefore. See, a lot of times if we just open up, you know, chapter 1 to just read that, we see that therefore. Well, that therefore, the original Greek, actually means so then. So if I'm going to see a therefore or a so then you know what? I want to know what he's talking about. Therefore what? I need to go back, you know, before that. Therefore actually kind of works as a hinge verse. It means it's connecting the prior thing to the future thing that he's getting ready to say. So in other words, if we go back and we read some of the scriptures before, then we can understand a better grasp on what Paul is saying in the future. It kind of works as a hinge verse. It swings both ways. And if you remember right, at the end of chapter 3 that we studied last week, Paul said this. He said, as a believer, our citizenship is in heaven. Isn't that what he said? He said, this earth ain't our home. We're just passing through. Our citizenship as a believer, we have a passport and it's marked with heaven. Therefore, see, this is where he can find his peace. See, if this world was just it, we'd have no peace. I mean, gosh, just look in the video that showed this morning. That's what goes on in our life. It goes on around the world all the time. Maybe not right here, you know, so much in our personal life, but it's going on. And we live in this chaotic world. And Paul says, hey, this home is not your own. Our citizenship is in heaven. He said, because my citizenship is in heaven, therefore, I'm going to tell you a few things. So listen up, and you're going to understand how you can have true peace. And that's what that word means when he says, therefore. He says, I have a kingdom focus, so listen up. And if we want to have an authentic peace, then the first thing that we need to do is we need to change our view. And number one, we need to change our view when it comes to others. We need to change our view when it comes to others. One of the reasons that we lack peace is because we do not view people the way that we should, especially when it comes to other believers. The reason why we do not experience peace like we should is because we are not viewing others the way that we should. I believe that with all my heart. And in these verses, Paul expresses his love for the body of Christ. In verse 1, he calls them brothers and sisters. Calls them brothers and sisters. Now, you know, on the surface, we might think, okay, this is Paul saying brothers and sisters. But what Paul's saying is he's recognizing that these people are part of the member of the family of God. That they're part of his family. There's so much more meaning when Paul said brothers and sisters than what we do when I say, hey, what's up, brother? What's up, sister? You know, Paul is saying, these guys are part of my family of God. And there's so much more in that. And he longs for them. He goes on to say, he said, hey, these are my brothers and sisters. I love them and I long for them. I long for them. He's saying, I love you. And I can't wait to be able to see you and spend my life and be around you again. I desire to see you again. Now, some of you might sit here and think, well, that's just Paul being sappy, you know? Well, true, that is Paul being sappy. It is. It is Paul being sappy. But can I tell you what? Paul's viewing others the way that Christ wants us to view others. Paul is viewing others the way that Christ wants us to see them. Do you know that God wants us to love the body of Christ? And Paul loved the body of Christ, and he wasn't afraid to verbalize that. He wasn't afraid to verbalize that. He wasn't afraid to say that. He wasn't afraid to say, listen, I love you. I love you, and I long to see you. I long to be with you in your life. Paul didn't have a problem with that. Can I ask you a question? Do you have a problem with that? Can you say that? Can you say that? Can you say that you honestly love God's church? Each and every one of you, can you say that you love Life Point Church? And listen, I'm not saying, do you love Life Point Church, like the idea, man, I love the music, I love the atmosphere, I love this, I love that. I'm not saying, do you love Life Point Church? I'm saying, do you love you? You? All of you, can you say, I love that person over there across the room? I don't even know you, but I love you. I love you because you're here at Life Point Church. And you know what? I know that if you're here, then you're searching for God. And because of that, I love you. I love you. Can you say that? Can you say that I love Life Point Church, that I love the believers that make up God's church? Can you say that you love God's people? And if so, how do you communicate that with them, to them? How do you say that to them? Now, you might be thinking right now, you might be saying, you know what, I'm just not the encouraging type. That's just not my gift. Can I tell you, you need to become one? You need to become the encouraging type. That's not an excuse that you're just not wired to encourage somebody. Because I tell you what, when you come to church, can I tell you it's not about you? Can I get an amen? It's not about you. It's not. I want you to come and I want you to get filled up. But you know what I want you to do? I want you to look for people to encourage and to lift up and to be a part of that. That's what the body of Christ is. And that's the way Paul looked at it. He said, man, I love you and I long to be with you. Everybody needs somebody in their life to encourage them. Thank God that 15 years ago, whenever I was a drunk and my life was falling apart and my wife wanted to divorce me, thank God that there was people in that church that met me and encouraged me exactly where I was at. They didn't condemn me. They didn't judge me. They loved on me where I was at, and they took Rhonda and I by the hand and they encouraged us and they walked us along and they mentored us because they loved us in Christ. Not because they loved us because they knew who we were. They didn't even know them. Half the people didn't know us. But they loved on us. Can you say that? Yeah, but I'm not the touchy-feely type of person. I'm not real good about going around telling everybody I love them and want to give them a hug and tell them I long for them. You know, that's fine. Honestly, I don't care. You don't have to. But how are you verbalizing it to people? How are you doing it? It doesn't matter the method, the formula, but does the church of God know that you love them? Every single one of us needs to be stretched in ourselves, and the people around us need to be aware that we love them, that we love them. Stretch yourself a little bit, guys. It doesn't matter what you want. It might be a little bit weird at first, but I tell you what, somebody needs your encouragement today. I believe that with all my heart. And you know what? Paul said this. He said, you know what? He said, I want you to know how much I love him. And this is what he said in Philippians. He said, you know what? You're my joy and you're my crown. You're my joy and crown. What he was meaning in Philippians is he was meaning that right now you're my present source of joy in my life. next to Jesus. I look at you as my joy. I look at you as my crown, and you're my present joy right now. And then he goes on later on, and he talks about the believers being his future crown. His future crown. You know, just like the words that we sang in the song earlier today. You know, Carrie wrote that song, and I tell you what, she wrote it with you guys in mind when she sat down and wrote it. And let me read the words to the song, or the scripture that this was based off of. And listen to this. In 1 Thessalonians 2:19, the Apostle Paul says this. Tell me if this sounds a little bit like the song. For what is our hope? What is our joy? What is our crown which we glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when he comes? It is you. It is you. Don't that sound like a lot like the song that we sang? You know, the Apostle Paul saying, it is you. Can I tell you right now that the reason why we do what we do at Life Point Church, the reason why I get up every single morning and spend time with God, the reason why I stand up here and preach, the reason why we pour our lives into people's life is because you are my joy and my crown. It's you. It's you. It's you. It's you. It's every single one of you. It's your guys' face I see when I'm praying to the Lord that God guide this church, lead us, help us to be the compassionate, loving people that God's called us to be. It's you. It's you. I don't even like speaking. I know that's hard to believe. But it is you. It is you. I want you to experience God on a different level. I want you to understand where true, authentic peace comes from. You are our crown and you are our joy. You're the reason why we do what we do. And because of that, can I tell you, it brings me great peace. It brings me great peace. What about you? Do you view others and pursue after them? Do you pursue other believers and pursue after them? Listen, or are you like so many other Christians that just is about yourself? You pursue after pleasure, position, prestige, popularity, possessions, and performance. And Paul says, you know what? You want lasting peace and joy than to pursue after people. Pursue after people. You know, people in God's word are eternal. Everything else is going to fade away. Everything else is going to fade away. All the dreams, all the things we accumulate, all that stuff, it's all going to fade away. But you know what? People will always be, and God's word will always be. So let me just ask you a couple really, really quick questions before we move on. Are you simply spending your time on earth, or are you investing your time in earth? See, there's a difference between spending and investing. Are you going through the motions? Are you spending your time on earth, or are you investing in other people? Let me ask you one more question here that's really going to make you think. If today you stood before Jesus, if Jesus returned, and today he looked at you and he said, listen, who is your joy and who is your crown? Would you be able to say anything? Who is your joy and who is your crown? Or would it leave you speechless? Who have you personally mentored? Who have you personally discipled? Who have you invested in? And can I tell you that someone right now you need to be able to say, that person right there is my joy. Right there, that person's my crown. Because you know what? I'm investing in them. I'm pouring my life into them. See, that's what the Apostle Paul was saying in Philippians. He said, man, I find great peace. I find great joy. Because it's you. It's you. You're my crown. You're my joy. You know what? If we want to understand peace, we need to view people differently. Don't you think? Don't you think? But then number two also, we need to view differently when it comes to perseverance. You know, the Apostle Paul calls the church to stand firm. Now, I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this because the entire message last week was about staying in the race and about staying strong and about standing firm. And if you missed it, then I encourage you to go online and check it out so you can be caught up. However, we are going to address just a few things here. We're going to be on here for just a second because I believe that a lot of people are not experiencing peace in their life because they're not standing firm in their walk with God. People are not standing firm spiritually in their walk with God, and that's why you've got chaos in your life, and that's why you do not have peace in your life. So it is something we're going to look at for just a second. See, the Apostle Paul, he was passionate, and several times throughout Scripture, he encouraged the believer to stand firm. several times throughout Scripture. Here's just a few. In 1 Corinthians 15:58, Paul says to stand firm, let nothing move you. In 1 Corinthians 16:13, he says stand firm in the faith. Galatians 5:1, he says stand firm and do not let yourself be burdened again by the yoke of slavery. In Ephesians 6:11, he says take your stand against the devil's scheme. In Ephesians 6:13, he says having done everything to stand. In Ephesians 6:14, he says stand firm with the belt of truth buckled around your waist. In Philippians 1:27, he says stand firm in one spirit. In Colossians 4:12, he says stand firm in the will of God. In 2 Thessalonians 2:15, he says stand firm and hold to the teachings that we passed on to you. Do you think the Apostle Paul wants us to stand firm? I think he does. I think he wants the believer in Christ to stand firm. Listen, guys, I've taught on this before, but I just want to remind you what this means. This word, stand firm, gives the appearance of a military term. It's a military term. And basically, the soldier has his commands to stand firm. He says, go get at your post and stand firm. Don't move. Don't come off your post. Don't walk away. You stand there, and even though the enemy's striking, even though he's coming from the north, even though he's coming from the south, the east, the west, and they're closing in on you, you stand firm, you stand your ground, and you stand your post. And that's what the Apostle Paul's saying here. He's saying, listen, guys, we're going to have attacks from all over the place, but you've got an enemy that wants to destroy our lives, take the peace out of it, and he says to stand firm. Stand firm. Quit tucking your tails and running every time things get rough, we run and retreat. You know what? When things get tough, we wave the right flag of surrender. When things get hard, we throw in the towel and we quit. And Paul says, don't quit. Don't quit. Stay the course. Keep on keeping on. Stand firm. Don't let the devil sway you away. Listen, guys, we have an enemy, and part of standing firm is being prepared so when the enemy strikes, we know it's him. It is critical that we know this because, you know what, Satan wants to destroy your marriage by having you look at something that you shouldn't, by having you cross the line when it comes to the opposite sex. He wants to destroy your integrity by telling you it's okay to just tell a half-truth if you can get the sale or the promotion. He wants to tell you it's okay to smidge just a little bit on your income tax because Uncle Sam doesn't need it anyway. He wants to destroy your family by letting your kids tell you, hey, I want to hang out with so-and-so even though it goes against my better judgment. Do you know your better judgment might be the Holy Spirit convicting you? Listen to it. He also wants to destroy by having involved in so many things and overloading your schedule where you've got so much on your life that you have anxiety from it. He also wants to destroy your health by convincing you to worry about everything. You know what? Just take another pill. Take another drink. Eat whatever you want. Never exercise. He wants to destroy your finances. Buy whatever you want. You deserve to be happy. You can always put it on your credit card and pay for it later. Listen, friend, he wants to destroy your life in any way possible to rob you from experiencing authentic peace. And the Apostle Paul says, stop. Listen, Christian. Listen, believer. Stand firm. Husbands, stand firm. Wives, stand firm. Parents, stand firm. Children, stand firm. Students, stand firm. Singles, stand firm. Whoever and wherever you are, whatever you're doing, in the name of Jesus, if you don't do anything else, stand firm. Stand firm. You want to experience peace? Man, change your view when it comes to perseverance. Because I tell you what, letting your guard down will lead to a chaotic life. However, in the midst of every circumstance, standing firm in Jesus will lead to peace. Will lead to peace. We need to change our view. Number three, when it comes to conflicts. We need to change our view when it comes to conflicts. So in verses 2 and 3, you know what? Paul switches gears here. He goes from love and encouragement to confronting conflict head on. Head on. Now, I know it's hard to believe because, you know, I think most of you feel like the Reeter family is just perfect. My kids never make mistakes. We never make mistakes. But can I tell you, we're not perfect. We're not perfect, and every once in a while we have chaos in our house. Every once in a while we got the kids doing this, doing that, and we got one that comes in with a bad attitude, and me and Rhonda, we try to nip it when it starts, and we'll say, Lucy. Lucy's shy. We'll say, Josie. We'll say, Josie, what's your problem? What's your problem? Stop it. Just stop it. You know you're trying to interrupt the peace in this home. Stop it. You got a bad attitude. And you need to stop it because it's infecting everyone around us. Listen, guys, the church is a family, and Paul knows when conflicts arise, if something's not done, it will spread like gangrene throughout the whole church body and eventually destroy the peace in the family of God. It just will. It will spread through it, and it'll go faster than anything. So Paul calls out these two ladies. He calls them out by name. And he says in verses 2 and 3, he says, I plead with Euodia, and I plead with Syntyche. He said, to be in the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you, my true companion, help these women, since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of the co-workers whose names are in the book of life. Listen, guys, these ladies, you know what? They weren't just a couple pew sitters. They weren't just a couple people that had just came in. These ladies were prominent, probably prominent leaders within that church. And you know what? Paul knew he had to stop it. Paul knew he had to do something about it. Can I tell you, it would be no different. It would be no different than us having a couple leaders within this church. All of a sudden, these conflicts arise, and they're at each other, and they're bickering. But yet, we're getting up here, and we're singing praises, and then we're going back behind the scenes, and we're arguing, and we're fighting. Can I tell you, God's not going to keep blessing that? That's why it would be really important for me as the pastor of this church to say, stop it. We got to quit the conflict. We got to agree to disagree. We got to put this thing to rest, because I tell you what, it'll fall away faster than it was that it grew. Because Satan gets in there and conflicts happen and conflicts happen, and then it just spreads like gangrene. And that's what Paul said, and he knew this, and that's why he dealt with it quickly. Because he said, you know what, if we're going to keep advancing the gospel, if we're going to keep sharing Jesus with this community, man, we got to look like Christ, right? We got to look like Christ. So this is what Paul does. Paul tenderly confronts them, and he even asks a few church leaders to step up and help with him. And Paul says this. He says, I plead with you guys. I plead with you to stop it. Just stop it. I plead with you to stop it. It doesn't matter who thinks they're right. You both are handling this wrong, so you both are at fault. Listen, ladies, you may have all kinds of differences, but you can still disagree agreeably and live in harmony and live in unity. Guys, we don't have to agree on everything, but we do need to live in unity. We need to be able to surrender that to God, and we need to be able to live in harmony. And the only way that we can do that is by having the same mind. And the only way to have the same mind is for you to have mine. Is that right? Is that right? The only way for us to have unity is you guys to share my mind. It's to have the mind of Christ. Right? That means if I have the mind of Christ and you have the mind of Christ and we're submitting and surrendering to the Holy Spirit, then don't you think He's going to help us through? See, we need to have the mind of Christ, not the mind of Brent, not the mind of somebody else. When you have the mind of Christ and you submit to one another, you extend mercy and for one another, you offer grace, you offer love, and you offer forgiveness. Listen, friend, how do you respond when somebody confronts you? How do you respond when somebody confronts you with conflict? Are you calm and accepting? Are you calm and accepting, or do you get mad and defensive? Calm and accepting, or mad and defensive when somebody says, hey, and calls you out? Now, let's go back to the story again, to set this up, of my family, when I call my kids out. Everything's all hunky-dory, as long as it's me calling my kids out. But somebody calls dad out, dad, what is your problem? You got a bad attitude. If I can bite my tongue long enough without blowing up, then usually, you know what, they're right. But that first initial reaction, I am not losing my mind, I'm not mad, I'm not losing my temper. You know, that's the first thing that I want to do, is I want to get argumentative, and I want to come out and get defensive. How are you when somebody calls you out? Do you accept responsibility? Do you sit back and say, you know what, you're right? How do you respond? Are you willing to look things and fix it and get it right, or do you want to argue and pass the buck? See, can I tell you, if you want to argue all the time, then basically is what you're telling me is the only way for you to experience peace is if everybody does everything your way. Right? The only way for you to experience peace is for everybody to do things your way. Well, good luck with that. Good luck with that, because that's never going to happen. And can I tell you that that's why most of you, or not most of you, but some of you are not experiencing peace right now in your life? Because you can't respect, you can't accept responsibility of the things that went wrong. So I want to ask you this question right now, speaking on conflict. Because guys, I tell you what, I want to protect this church. I want to protect this church. So my question that I asked the first service, and I'm going to ask you guys, is there somebody in your life that you need to make things right with? Is there somebody in your life that you have a conflict going on that you need to make things right with? Is it a friend? Is it a coworker? Is it a brother and sister in Christ? Is it somebody in this service sitting across the room? Is it somebody that was in the opposite service than you? If there is a conflict in any kind, then I am calling you out right now. Go get it right. Go get it right. Don't let it fester. You want to experience peace in your life? Give it God. give it to God, get it right with others. If you want peace, we need to change our view of a few things. We need to love other peoples like Christ do. We need to stand firm and persevere spiritually. We need to forgive and ask for forgiveness. But Paul says, you know what? We can't stop there. You also need to Roman numeral number two. You need to change your actions. You need to change your actions. In the next section here, Paul gives us some commands. And I want you to understand that if you want to experience peace, these aren't suggestions. They're not suggestions. They're not like, hey, if you want to, you can. If you don't want to. Paul's giving us some commands, and he's saying, hey, if you do this, you'll get some peace. And if you want to experience peace, then you'll implement these in your life. And the first thing that Paul commands us to do is, number one, we need to rejoice always. We need to rejoice always. Paul's first command is really actually quite simple. Verse 4 says this. It says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. However, as short and simple and to the point as this is, it's also the most difficult to obey, isn't it? It's the most difficult to obey. It's not really that easy. W.C. Fields said this. He said, I start off each day with a smile and get it over with. You ever felt like that someday? You know, I'm just going to start off with a smile and just get it out of the way. You know, there's two ways that you can face the day. There's two ways you can face the day. You can wake up in the morning and you can say, good Lord, it's morning. Or you can get up and you can say, good morning, Lord. It's your choice. It's your choice how you want to face the day. Listen, guys, Paul says this. He says, you want peace? Choose to rejoice. In this verse, he gives the command to rejoice not once, but twice. It's the only command that he repeated twice. And I believe that he knew that they and we would struggle with that, because I believe that he knew we would have difficult people in our life to deal with. I believe that he knew that we were going to have difficult circumstances in our life to go through and to deal with. And so that reason, Paul says, I'm encouraging us and reminding us to rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. You know what happens? So many problems, so many times the problem is that we face face our problems with trying to be happy. God wants us to be happy. He wants us to be happy. This doesn't make me happy. This doesn't make me happy. This doesn't make me happy. And we let our happiness be determined based on our circumstances and the people that we are going through. And Paul says, hey, that can't be. We need to find our joy in something more, because we're always going to have circumstances that we don't completely enjoy. If you remember right, in Philippians, when Paul writes this letter of joy, it just comes on the shirt tails of Paul. He'd been beaten several times, stoned several times, shipwrecked. He'd been put in prison, and now he's chained to a Roman soldier 24 hours a day, getting ready to wait trial that he's thinking might end in death. But yet he tells us to enjoy, and to enjoy life, and to rejoice always. Isn't that amazing? I would say it's not based on his circumstances, is it? Listen, guys, if we're going to go through circumstances in life we don't enjoy, but if you want to, we are going to go through circumstances we don't enjoy, but if you want to have peace, then you know what? We need to have joy in the midst of them. We need to have joy in the midst of them. Fanny Crosby wrote over 8,000 hymns. Blessed Assurance, praise him, to God be the glory. And she lost her sight when she was only 6 weeks old, and she lived into her 90s, composing thousands of beloved hymns. And on her 92nd birthday, she cheerfully said, if in all the world you can find a happier, more joyous person than I am, do bring him to me. I should like to shake his hand. I would say Fanny Crosby knew the understanding of rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Don't you? Guys, can I tell you, we need to quit bellyaching about everything. Let's just quit being naysayers about everything and bellyaching and complaining around. Why don't we just choose to rejoice? Choose to rejoice. God's still alive. He's still on the throne. And then Paul commands us, number two, to be gentle. To be gentle. Paul continues to deal with conflict in a godly manner. And he says in verse 5, he says, let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. So in the middle of conflict, you know what? We're to be gentle. We're to win our enemies over with gentleness. Scripture says a gentle answer turns away wrath. So if someone doesn't like you and you feel like that you don't even like being around them and you feel like they're out to get you all the time, you need to show gentleness to them. Can I get an amen? Isn't that exciting? Somebody's mean to you, be gentle. Be gentle. It's not always easy. The word here translated gentleness is probably best understood as yielded rights. It means that we are to be gentle and yielded people. You know what? We should not be people that gets ticked off and bent out of shape when something doesn't go our way. And what happens is when we get bent out of shape and something doesn't go our way, we start demanding our rights. And you know what happens when we start demanding our rights? Peace is right out the window, right? Any peace I had, I'm just going to roll down the window and throw it out because I'm mad right now because I'm not getting my way. And Paul says, man, let your gentleness be known to all. So, would people that know you best consider you a gentle person? Would people that know you best consider you a gentle person? Let me ask you another question. What about the people that like you least? What about the people that like you least? Would they consider you a gentle person? Because I tell you what, it's easy to be gentle. That's the real test. It's easy to be gentle with people that are nice to you, right? What about when somebody's a jerk to you? What about when somebody cuts you off in traffic? What about that coworker that got the cell, got in front of you and did that? Or what about the umpire at the ball game that missed the, you know, just set out to make your life miserable and missed the call on purpose or call the wrong shot? Do the people that like you least look at you and say, you know what, you're a gentle person? The apostle said, Paul says, you know what, you want to experience peace? He said, let your gentleness be evident to all. To all. Not a select few, to all. And then Paul says in number three, don't worry, pray. You know, in verse 6 and 7, he says, don't be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So again, the theme of today is obtaining peace, obtaining more peace in our lives. And Paul says, you know what? You want peace? Be anxious for nothing. Be anxious for nothing. Don't be anxious. Don't worry about anything. Listen, guys, I understand and I know that it's easier said than done, but can I tell you that worry is a waste of time? Worrying is a waste of time. And I would love to stand up here and say that I have this mastered, that I never worry about a single thing. I am a work in progress just like everybody else, but can I tell you also, I'm not satisfied with when I do worry. I want to get that right. I want to trust God more and worry less. Listen, guys, worrying is wasted energy and it's wasted time. And more times than not, we make a bigger deal out of things than what they really are. So I'm going to ask you, are you overreacting to anything today? Is there anything that you're worrying about today that you need to let go of? Every single time I talk about worry, I read these statistics because I want to drive them into your head, because I want us to remember it. Because honestly, 90% of the things that I say today, you're going to walk away and completely forget them anyway. So you might not even remember these statistics that I shared, but they're so truthful and they're so good. There was a study done at Harvard, and this is what they found out. 40% of the things that we worry about never happen. 40% of the things that we worry about never happen. 30% concern our past. 12% are needless worries about health, and 10% are petty issues. And only 8% of the things that we worry about are actually legitimate concerns. That means 92% of the things that we worry about is wasted energy. 92% of the things that we worry about is wasted energy. Worry is stewing without doing. And I'm going to get a little bit more bold. Do you understand that worry is sin? Worry is sin. You know, we pick out all of our favorite sins that we don't do that everybody else has got, but yet we're worry boards, and we worry about everything, and worry is sin, because this is what it means to worry. Basically, we're saying this as a believer in God. If we've trusted Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we're basically saying this. We're saying, you know what, God, I believe in you. I believe that you're the creator of all things. I believe that you spoke us into existence. I believe that because of sin, we were separated from you. And I believe that you sent your son Jesus to live a perfect life, die on the cross. I believe 3 days later, he rose from the dead. I believe that if I repent of my sins, ask you to come into my heart, then you supernaturally, miraculously come inside of me and live inside of me so I can have eternity someday. But I don't believe you're big enough to do this. I do not believe you're big enough to do this. I believe you're big enough to do all this other thing, but I do not believe you're big enough to do this. That's what worrying is. It's worrying, and it's worrying, and it's worrying. It's taking the trust from God, and God says it's sin. Worry is sin. You know what? We got to lay it down, and until we come to grips with it, until we say that this is a sin that I'm struggling with, and until we understand that it's sin, we can never change anything, because you can't change anything you don't own, right? So if you're a worrier, you got to understand it's sin, and you got to lay it down. Now listen, guys, I'm not trying to make light out of anybody's situation, because I know we all have a set of challenges that we're faced with. Some of you, I know you're going through health problems, you're going through job problems, school problems, finance problems, marriage problems, family problems, relationships problems, and you've got big decisions to make. But here's my question. Here's my question. Do you know for certain what the future will bring concerning these issues in your life? You don't, do you? You have no idea what's going to happen with these issues. So then, let me ask you another question. Can worrying change any of your circumstances? It can't, can it? No matter how much I worry, it's not going to change a single thing. So why do I worry? Why do we worry? Corrie Ten Boom said this, shared this truth. Worry does not empty tomorrow of its sorrows. It empties today of its strength. Listen, guys, the past is done. The future's not yet. Why are you letting worry ruin the present? It's the only moment we have. Understand that worry and prayer are complete opposite. Worry and prayer are complete opposite. It's like water and fire. You can worry and you can pray, but you can't do both of them at the same time. It's impossible. They are completely opposite. You cannot worry and pray at the same time. And Paul gives us a few tips. He says, you know what? You need to pray about everything. You need to pray with thanksgiving. You need to pray with expectation. And prayer puts the concentration on the Lord. Prayer puts concentration on the Lord. I had somebody this week I was visiting with, and they said, I have no idea how to pray. You know what prayer is? It's just talking. It's just talking to God throughout the day. God, I need help. I need this. I need that. God, I'm sinning again because I'm worrying. Lord, help me to put that trust in you. Help me to do this. Help me to do that. It's just talking with God all day long. Listen, guys, we're wrapping this up. We're getting real close. You know, when you put your concentration on the Lord, it takes the burdens and it puts them to Him, and it replaces them with something better. And in verse 7 says this, and the peace of God that transcends all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. The word guard is another military term. It refers to a soldier guarding the city gate from inside. So in other words, when we pray, that God's peace becomes the guard of our heart, and He's protecting us from the cares and the world that destroys us. Don't that sound good? He's going to guard our hearts when we pray. If we want to experience peace, then we must take everything to the Lord in prayer. And then finally, number 4, we need to think better thoughts. You know, oftentimes our default mode goes to the worst. When it comes to a situation we're in, when it comes to people, when it comes to whatever, if we're ever going to have a peace, then we need to stop it. We need to stop letting our minds take off and go south and become negative. This passage in verse 8 says, finally, brothers, whatever and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is noble and excellent or praiseworthy, then think about these things. Listen, guys, your thoughts are going to direct the outcome of your life. Your thoughts are going to direct the outcome of your life. Now, you might say, I don't believe that. I don't believe that at all. Let me just give you a thought to chew on. The average person has the minimum of 10,000 separate thoughts each day. That works out to be 3.5 million thoughts a year. And if you live to be 75, then you'll have over 26 million different thoughts. Already, most of you had over 2,000 separate thoughts since you got out of bed this morning. And you're probably going to have another 8,000 before you hit the sack tonight. And then you're going to start all over again tomorrow. It's no wonder we're emotionally and mentally exhausted, isn't it? It is. Our brains doesn't shut off. And Paul's saying, listen, church, your thoughts are important. You want to know why your thoughts are important? Because sin starts in the mind. Sin starts in the mind. You start thinking it, and you start dwelling on it, and you start going after it. But can I also tell you what else starts in the mind? Holiness. Holiness starts in the mind. It's your choice. You can choose to take the negative route, or you can choose to take the God route. So I believe that absolutely your will direct the outcome of your life. Change your thoughts and you change your life. Take every thought captive, throw out the ones that don't glorify God, and meditate on the things that are true, noble, right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, or praiseworthy. And then verse 9 tells us, and the God of peace will be with you. Amen. I'm going to ask the praise team to come on up. I want us to wrap this up here. And while they're coming up here, I just want to do a quick recap right now. And I want to ask you, is your life marked with peace? Do you have a peace in your life, or is most of the things that you're going through, is your life more chaotic than it is peaceful? If you do not have a life that's marked with peace, then the Apostle Paul says, you know what? You need to change your view. Quit having an earthly view of things. Get kingdom focused. Get kingdom focus. Change your view of people. Start loving people, investing in them. You know what? Stand firm spiritually. Don't back down. And then learn to forgive. Learn to forgive. Learn to ask for forgiveness. And then he says, you know what? There's some things we need to put in action. We need to rejoice in everything. Have a gentle spirit. Quit worrying and start praying. And finally, quit focusing on the negative and start thinking better thoughts. You know what? All these things that Paul talked about, that all is what the mind of Christ looks like. It's how you operate, and that's what it looks like. But can I tell you, it is impossible to have the mind of Christ if you don't first have the Prince of Peace in your life. It's impossible. You can try all you want to make things happen, but until you choose peace, the Prince of Peace, can't experience anything else. I'm going to ask you to stand at your feet right now. You want peace in your life? You tired of chaos? You tired of your world falling apart around you? Then trust the Prince of Peace today. You know, the table's set. You're invited to the table. You're invited to come and understand and accept Him and receive Him. But I do believe it's a choice. I believe it's a choice. God's not going to press Himself and force Himself on anybody. He truly gives us a gift, and it's our choice to receive Him or not to receive Him. So I'm going to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes for just a second. And I'm going to ask you today, with the table set and all the information before you, do you want the Prince of Peace in your life if He's not there? If you do want to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the true Prince of Peace, I want you to raise your hand right now today and say, that's me. I want to know Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Would you raise your hand? Nobody's looking. Everybody's bowed and eyes closed. Raise up your hand so I can see you. I see you back in the corner there. Somebody's going to give you something here real quick so I can follow up with you later on. Anybody else? I see your hands right here. I want you to, you're going to get a clipboard, and I want you to fill something out and give it to me here in just a second. Anybody else? I want to understand the peace of God, and I want Him to be in my life. I want us to say this prayer together. Say, dear God, I believe in You. I need Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I repent of my sins. I ask You to forgive me. Come into my life. Save me. Help me to live for You. Fill me with Your Spirit. Lord, I need Your peace in every area. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Guys, listen. If you are a believer in God, if you've already experienced in that peace, then who's your crown and who's your joy? Are you pouring your life into anybody? Do not make Christianity about yourself. It's about others. We are going to sing the table and be dismissed. I encourage you, make sure you're here next Sunday. Make sure you're here Wednesday night to go out and minister to our community. I do love you guys. And I can honestly tell you, I long to see you every Wednesday, every Sunday, and every time I see you. You are my crown and my joy. And I love you. Bottom of my heart. Let's sing.